online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hey there, Banshees. Welcome back to the Banshee After Show here on AfterBuzz TV. There it is. Talking about season 3, episode 8, All the Wisdom I've Got Left. I'm Matt Lieberman. Joining me as always, fantastic panel is here. Oriana Leo is back.
Hello, Banshee babes.
Yes, Monis Rose is here.
What's going on?
And Isaac Johnson is here.
What's up, everybody?
Now, in just under 20 minutes, showrunner, executive producer, director...
Sheriff.
I guess sheriff of the proverbial town banshee.
Yes.
Greg Yaitanes is going to be joining us live on the show via phone. We're really, really excited to have him. It's always great to get to talk to him. He's a friend of the show, and he's responsible for this great, great piece of television.
And he would be here if he weren't already working on a new project.
Yes. Hopefully maybe we can get a couple answers out of him before he leaves today. So let's jump right in. This is the second episode of the two that Greg directed this season. He directed episode 7. He directed episode 8. I want to jump right in with this sequence in New Orleans. Just very beautifully shot, right on real locations. How did it feel for the rest of you watching Chaitin go down for the last time?
Well, really quick, it wasn't really about... I mean, yes, we'll talk about Chaitin, but you mentioned New Orleans. And at least Greg and all the crew members, they really used New Orleans. They really used... When you film in New Orleans, you have to make that city its own character, and I feel they did very well in that, especially in the music. You know, it opened up with the swamp music. We got a little bit of the blues and a live session of the blues. They used, you know, some temp tracks, like some bluesy temp tracks throughout, so we really felt, you know, the French Quarter, the swamps, the docks. I really felt I was in it besides just the B-roll.
Right, there was a terrific sense of place. Like, especially for me, when he and Chaitin are fighting in that room in the French Quarter and having them bust through the wall out onto the balcony, and just the fact that they're shooting right there on location is huge. It says so much about, you know, how they value grounding this show, as ridiculous at times as the action can be, grounding it in the world and making it feel like we're right there with them. Isaac?
Yeah, I thought the fight was cool. Both fights were cool. I mean, it always feels real. The action always feels absolutely, like you said, grounded. And I like putting Hood in a situation where, one, we're in the fight club, he gives himself no out there, and then you see him in the room fighting, and just, you know, how, like, when Hoon Lee was here, he said that he'll always elevate, and he'll use anything he can because he is pretty much overmatched with Chaitin.
Right. What'd you think, Oriana?
I loved it. I felt the same way about New Orleans. I have been there. I mean, I felt like I was there, except I wasn't sweating and gross. But the music, and especially the final kind of crane camera shots, were just incredible. And actually, it took my breath away. But I really did feel like we were out. We weren't in Kansas anymore. You know, we were really out of the comfort zone and the realm of Banshee, where all things are possible. And to be in New Orleans and it's on Chaitin's new turf, I loved it.
Yeah, well, it feels like the sense of danger in many ways is renewed because there's nothing familiar around. We have no other allies. It's just him and Brock. And I love this opening sequence as they're heading in the airboat off to this 8th Ward territory. Casting, where do you find that guy who plays Sandy Crow? I imagine that's an impression. Yeah, I love this fight club sequence. You get this very real, again, sense of place. This the guy who runs it sweating in his white suit just in the middle of the night, and just the sheer brutality of the fight sequences in this episode, I just truly have to applaud. Oh, yeah,
the Colonel Sanders MC, what does he say? He says, like, from God knows where, what does he say? Yeah. He says something like...
And weighing in at who gives a fuck.
Yeah.
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 Beautiful.
I loved that stare down and where he snaps his neck. Like, only when he sees Hood does he make that decision to snap the neck. Like, he just takes it to that level every time now.
Yeah. Well, what is Hood thinking here? He knows that he can't take him, but he still just jumps right in. He's just blinded with rage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, he's not thinking. Yeah. I don't think he's thinking at all. But also, like, does he know that he can't? I think he's just so hell-bent on vengeance. It doesn't matter to him.
Right.
This is maybe the worst scenario to fight him, because, you know, it's either you die or you live here.
And it's Chayton's home turf.
And his home turf, and they love him, you know. And luckily, Brock bails him out there.
Mm-hmm. Kind of. I feel like he's always messing it up.
No, he's spoiling. Brock is spoiling the moment.
The first time he bails him out, because he was absolutely going to die there.
Yes.
If he doesn't do it, then we have a dead Hood there, which we can't have. The second time, I was like, oh, he was gonna, okay.
But I think that Hood is okay with dying trying, you know? Like, that's part of his MO. I don't think he gives a rat's ass. He has nothing else to live for at this point. He should want to live for Deva, but I think he's just blinded that he wouldn't care.
Yeah, if he died trying. Matt, you've mentioned this time and time again that, you know, Hood is like a wolf. I mean, he's like this beast. He doesn't think. He's just going to go for it. He's not going to think. I mean, you have said this in the past when Hood has picked his fights or was in fights. I mean, that's who he is. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I understood that. I mean, going in and him just attacking Chayton.
Well, one of my favorite things about this episode and about the way that Chayton goes, and it's an incredibly brutal death. And it serves... I was talking to Greg about this at the screening of this episode a few weeks ago. Is that it serves two purposes. One, Chayton is such a powerful foe and is such a fan favorite that unless you make it abundantly clear that there is no walking away from this situation, abundantly clear that he's dead, people will assume that he can come back in some way.
What's going to happen is the alligators are going to eat him. He's going to be reincarnated as this half-man, half-alligator
guy. No, he's
going to
be
God.
Reincarnated as just a crew of alligators.
Yeah.
100%.
Don't think so.
It's going to happen. Listen, Season 5.
Native American mythology, it could happen.
Yeah,
okay, it's just him versus the alligators. You eat your enemy and you get their powers.
So, I said it was twofold. That's the first reason.
Okay.
Make sure beyond any shadow of a doubt, Chayton is dead. And two, we have to remember at this point in the story that our hero is still not that great a guy. No matter how much we may canonize him, because we love seeing him succeed and we want to see him not only get everything that he wants, but continue to become a better person, to become a better father, to, you know, rip off people who deserve to be ripped off, to kill people who deserve to die. He is effectively our hero, but we have to remember, this is still a guy who is maybe 6 months out of a 15-year prison sentence, and before that, had very little to no morality.
So I feel like this speaks to what I'm reading into as his military training. We get at the end of the episode, we hear Colonel Stowe's assessment of him, and I was really excited about it. But it just makes me think that he has already been programmed. He's been programmed. His identity has already been taken away. He's trying to find it now, and he's trying to find a home. But he's a killing machine. It's his first instinct. And I was thinking about how ridiculous, you know, some of the injuries that he receives. The bandage. Oh, my God. Change the bandage. But if you think about actual SEALs, you know, like Black Ops or whatever, these really ultra high level warriors, they are warriors. I remember reading a story about a guy who had a broken femur and carried his buddy 10 miles through Afghani Canyon because they literally pick these superhuman people that don't feel pain the same way. So in my mind, that's where I like this to go, that he has already been turned into this killing machine and he's trying to refine his humanity, but that's why he acts this way.
I think that pointing that shotgun at him point blank and blowing away, I would say, 60% of his skull.
Which, by the way, that was like the killing of Gus French from Breaking Bad times 11, though. Times, like, they, I mean, Greg and the crew I mean, they won up that. I mean, Oriana was, we saw this together, and Oriana was like, the eye, look at the eye. It just is hanging, it's hanging.
It's my favorite thing I've ever seen is an eyeball hanging by the brain, by the optical nerve is what it is. And big shout out to Lonnie Peristere at Zoic Studios because they handled those VFX as far as I know.
Yeah, man, took it right out of my mouth there. So close. I was like, I was going to ask Greg, is that a little bit of a nod to Breaking Bad? Although I guess we've heard Greg is watching. So Greg, when you come on,
Yeah,
I want to know if that's just that. a little tip of the cap there to Breaking Bad. Yes.
Yeah. I also love that we that cemetery that we had that shootout in. That's the same cemetery that was used in the movie Easy Rider when having that psychedelic freak out in New Orleans. Yeah, it's exactly it's great. Definitely the same cemetery. But again, very very effective. I want to talk briefly about what's going on between Brock and Hood after they dump the body, and Brock's desperation trying to get Hood to just hang in there to finish what he started and take care of Kai Proctor.
Well, you had him earlier in the episode when they're kind of sitting on the steps talking, like trying to lure Chaitin out, and him saying, like, you know, I've never really asked you, like, where you're from, and, you know, never figured you out. Like, I've always had a sense that Brock has some idea that he's not a legit sheriff or something like that. So then you have them later in this thing talking about, you know, like Brock saying like what he cares about, even though he's killed and, you know, that they're killers or whatever. But I saw him seeing in Hood being that, like, even though I'm suspicious of this person, he's still someone who's not scared by Kai. And that's a very important thing to him as he's watched his town deteriorate, you know, through the efforts of Kai.
Yeah, well, he sees a hope in him. Because you have to remember, last season and the first season, he wasn't just suspicious. He was actively working against the sheriff. Yeah. He was doing anything that he could to undermine him. Something's not adding up. Mm-hmm. But now it just doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. He is the most effective method of cleaning up his hometown permanently.
Mm-hmm. You know, when I saw the scene, I thought, you know, I was a little maybe confused, and after thinking about it, this scene was needed. Brock, especially, like, now, it was needed because, you know, really, Chaitin was just a subplot. This was really just a C storyline. The main storyline was, like, Kai and dealing. I mean, I felt it was that, and Brock was bringing it back to that. I mean, you know, yes, Chaitin, we got sidetracked a little bit, and now that is gone, and, you know, yes, I mean, the Sheriff Hood is about to just give up, and it's like, no, let's stay focused. We had to get sidetracked. Let's stay on the path.
Well, that's a very good point, because when we first came into this series, even though Rabbit was the ever-looming personal threat to Hood, Kai Proctor, we saw him committing far more atrocities back then. He felt like more of a threat back then. We were actively working against him back then, way back in season one. And this season, he's been undergoing this metamorphosis, trying to explore whether or not he is doomed to be the terrible person that he has always seemed to be. In this episode, he gets as close as he's ever been to the side of light, being rebaptized into his family's church, his father's acceptance of him, only to have it ripped away in front of Emily and everyone he's ever known in the Amish community as Frasier's people kidnap him, kidnap Emily, and drive off with them because of Rebecca's actions. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Rebecca and Burton.
So
rude awakening there.
She went somewhere she shouldn't have gone.
Well, and she found out something she didn't know.
So he's a
she
eunuch.
Didn't want to know.
Yeah,
what is it? Probably,
Well, I was live tweeting on Friday night. Hey, to everyone that was live tweeting, and Greg said, it's not what you think it is.
I don't think that it's just balls that are missing.
Okay.
I think the whole thing has just been hacked to hell.
I guess, is that the difference with a eunuch? Well, I mean, obviously,
a eunuch has no testicles.
Okay.
That's a eunuch.
Okay. Well,
It could be that there still are testicles and there's just
nothing
no
else.
Penis.
Oh my gosh.
Could be.
That would be horrifying.
We can ask Greg when he gets. my calm fascination with it is almost scary to me.
It is.
No. It's just testicles.
Yeah.
But in any case.
But it could be anything. We saw that little backstory that was an origin with Kai and Burton down the dungeon.
Their first meeting.
the hell put them down there? I really want to know.
I'm very curious.
Very curious.
And hopefully we'll have that answered by the end of the series. What I want to know from you guys is I want to talk about Rebecca, who has been gaining not only just an increased sense of confidence, mm-hmm. but just sort of a level of reckless invulnerability. Mm. She thinks that she's untouchable. And the fact that she goes for the sexual move mm-hmm. with Burton just shows how unaware she is, how naive she is about how deep she's getting. She thinks that she can just walk through fire and come out unburned. But there's a reckoning coming, and unfortunately it's going to hit Kai and Emily first.
Yeah.
Well, it's taken out of envy and jealousy. This is, I mean, her motivation. I mean, I feel she's just that, because she is still like a teenager or about, you know, maybe 17, 18. I mean, she's still, right? I mean,
yeah, somewhere around there.
I mean, she's kind of messed up in the head from her relationship with Kai, from her,
his very special
yes,
niece.
Yeah, she said it.
I was like, ooh.
Exactly. I mean, she's envious, jealous, and this is how she's reacting. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not the typical teenage yelling at the parents type of
reaction. She didn't get the chance. No. This is her rebellion. She's definitely missing a couple marbles, I think.
What I thought was interesting was that, like, as she's going for the move to Burton, he doesn't stop her at all. He knows what she's doing, like, the second mm-hmm. that she, you know, she starts
in.
He wants her to know, and even when she reaches down there, his face just, like, nothing going mm-hmm. on, just like, yeah, and what of it?
Mm-hmm. And I thought was interesting because he seemed so strong,
mm-hmm.
but then he breaks down afterwards, after she threatens him.
Well, that's the thing, is who he is with glasses on and who he is with glasses off are effectively, right. to him, two different people. Mm. And he was being the strong Burton with the glasses mm-hmm. on until she left, and he was able to let that sense of pain and rage, and knowing that no matter what he does for Kai, that she will always be closer to his heart. That no matter how much he cares about him, she can still undermine him utterly. And there's nothing he can do about it. And that's got to be so painful for him.
Yeah, well, I got the sense that it was much more about that than mm-hmm. whatever is or isn't there in his pants.
I feel also we learn one more thing. There's one more side. So we got the glasses on Burton. We got the glasses off Burton. But also the foggy glasses Burton. I'm just saying, his glasses, you know, they were fogging quite a bit in this episode.
I don't know, but
I'm just saying we're going to get the foggy glasses Burton.
Okay.
Are we going to get to Job before
I think we should talk about that right now. I love this subplot. I feel like Sugar and Job kind of get the short shrift sometimes when it comes to character mm-hmm. development, simply because more often than not, they are working on whatever criminal enterprise the group has going while everyone else is stuck in their own problems. Mm-hmm. I've always loved this pairing, and I think this is maybe their best episode together, as Job bails Sugar out of what he thinks is a generous act, but is actually him getting thoroughly scammed. Mm-hmm. And I loved Job's outfit and makeup in the car.
Not just in the car, but that fight scene. He literally shows up like a torero, which is the mascot of my school and University of San Diego. Bullfighter. With the little patent leather slippers and the lacy shirt and mm-hmm. the little bolero jacket. I was like, Job, you go, Job.
Which actually, of all the fights in this episode, I felt this fight that Oriana, that you're talking about, was the best fight. This was the star fight for me because of the glamour, the shebang.
The glamour. And I love, he was really bobbing and weaving and
he took them down in three hits, maybe?
It was beautiful.
Three punches, pow, done.
Yeah, the guy doesn't lay a hand on him once, but like, yeah, the float like a butterfly thing.
I'm here to make you a better man. I'm going to steal that.
Yeah. I didn't say I gave it all back.
Yeah.
I loved that.
He's just so good.
I like, it's cool though to see Job looking out for Sugar. You know, like that mm-hmm. loyalty there. And I kind of wondered, and this may be like a stretch, but we had Hood sort of leaving him in hot water last episode. He almost died. And being really upset with him by the end of the episode. And it seems maybe he's turned some of that loyalty to Sugar.
Well,
it might be a stretch, but
this is his family.
Yeah.
This is all he has. I mean, well, this is, you're going to fight for your friends, your family. Mm-hmm.
Well, plus, there was a really great juxtaposition of who these people were. You know, Sugar's living in the past. Job is clearly, and he even said it, he's all about the hair and now. And that's who he is.
I believe we have Greg Yaitanes on the line. Greg, you with us?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hey, Greg, thank you so much for joining us, man. How are you?
No, it's cool. I'm watching you guys live.
Yeah!
Thank you.
What's going on?
I can see the reactions. I make sure I don't talk too much when I'm on the phone.
So you directed this episode, and I'm sure you're very proud of it, this episode and the previous one. How are you feeling about people's reactions to it?
I mean, the reaction, you know, across 7 and into 8 has been phenomenal. It was exciting to see, you know, everybody, you know, get the payoff that they were hoping for, and then some. So, you know, I was in New York actually Friday night, and was following the Twitter feed right at 10 o'clock. So, I made sure to see what the fan reaction was to Chayden getting his head blown off. I was thoroughly satisfied. It was very gratifying making this, you know, 6 months ago, and then seeing the payoff, you know, now.
Yeah. So let's talk. We were on the subject of Sugar and Job, and I think maybe we'll finish that out before we jump around to some of the things we've already discussed. This relationship, I think, is one of the strongest on the show, and I'm sure that as a showrunner, you must have been really excited to give them a plot line that was far more grounded in their relationship than about accomplishing a goal.
It was something that, you know, that particular episode, we were, you know, we got so focused on what was happening in New Orleans that I remember Jonathan saying, like, you know, we should figure out what's going on with, you know, Sugar and Job. And, you know, the danger of a story like that is that it can feel like what it is, which is like a C story. Mm-hmm. And the fact that, you know, those two characters have banked so much goodwill, and the editorial approach that we took on it, I think, got it away from that. But, you know, everybody's been hungry to watch those two and go off on those stories. So to be able to, you know, tie together an idea we had at the beginning of season 2, where Sugar's looking at that photograph, and to pay it off, you know, 17 episodes, 18 episodes later, it's like great to be able to do that kind of math with Jonathan.
Wow.
That's awesome. I have a question. I feel like Joe gets the most comedy on the show, and like all these great one-liners. Is there one specific person who writes those?
Is there one specific person that writes that?
Yeah, writes like all the great like zingers that Job has.
You know, Jonathan is you know, I guess the end voice of Job. I mean, while all the writers have taken a crack,
mm-hmm.
You know, it comes very easily for Jonathan. In fact, he always has to pull himself back so much. So. It's actually really tricky. It's a very hard tone to get right. I would say that's been the thing that we've consistently found challenging with when people aren't, other than Jonathan, are writing. It becomes very difficult to, it can fall into camp very quickly, or it can be kind of an imitation of itself. And, you know, Hoon has a great perspective on that. Jonathan has a great perspective on that. Adam understands that. But it's a tough tone to nail because it can fall into something else, kind of a parody of itself, very quickly. And, you know, we're always trying to police that, and Hoon's kind of the last backstop of making sure the character is, you know, true to itself.
I really liked, especially when with the Job and Sugar, to me, Greg, this was the first time that you were actually playing some music in the Forge. You know, the jukebox was going on, and I really liked that, you know. And also, this was very a music heavy episode, I felt. You had a lot of needle drops, more than just score and temp scores. And I really appreciated that. It really not just uplifted, you know, it helped the environment, the location and the setting of the New Orleans, but also, yeah, even the Forge, it made the Forge more warmth, just having some jukebox music in the background.
Yeah, we haven't, that's good you noticed that, thank you. It's hard to do a New Orleans episode without having that infect everything that you're working on. In fact, we put a kind of a New Orleans track at the end of episode 7 to tee up the promise of episode 8. We actually, was a song that we had originally, I had Animal, which is the Sweet Bumpet song that's at the end of 8, actually at the end of 7, and just found that we want the promise of New Orleans, and then when New Orleans is kind of gone, we're back into Banshee and sink back into the world of Banshee. So we put more cues in this episode. We had a live, you know, Big Bill is actually the oldest son of Muddy Waters, and he was performing live for us in the bar with Brock.
Wow.
In New Orleans. So the live music component, and then that we brought that into the forge. You know, ultimately, my goal was to get a very meditative wood chase, mm-hmm. And a counterintuitive and not being driven by pulsing action music. And Chris Dirksen, who you know, heads up Methodic Doubt, really was able to tie that together, knowing that the kind of needle drop music, as you said, is really inhabiting the episode. So we went to a real moment of quiet.
Yeah. What was the most important thing to you as a director, as a storyteller, about this final hunt and confrontation between Hood and Chayden?
You know, we have certain cities that we felt like are in the vocabulary of Banshee. New York's been one, New Orleans is another. Ever, you know, there was an opportunity to go to like a place like San Francisco, places that are very textured, have a whole underbelly to them that is unseen. And there's something very texturally uneasy about New Orleans when you're here and you don't know the city yet and you don't see it like a tourist. It has a whole other culture that is really fascinating and one that I'm exploring in my next series. Mm-hmm. So for us, it was really about giving a proper depth, giving something that was counterintuitive to what people would expect, some big fight. You know, we wanted to front load the fight club, the underground fight club, you know, just to get people to not expect how it was going to unfold. And it was really, you know, with epic tension and build that we wanted to create that. It was important to see that, you know, Chayden, after everything you felt and everything that you got a chance to kind of come to terms with what was about to happen and be on that last, you know, final chase through the, you know, through the Big Easy.
Yeah. What was it like shooting on location in the French Quarter? One of my favorite moments in the episode, and I said it earlier in this podcast, is when they're fighting in that room and we burst out onto the balcony to show that we really are there. This isn't a soundstage. You know, we're fighting right in the middle of the French Quarter.
Yeah, that's very deliberate, so we could, you know, I can do a hotel room anywhere, in fact.
Right.
Yeah, you know, there is a lot of that episode. You know, the fight club is actually in North Carolina where we shot. You know, they get off the airboat in New Orleans, but then they walk back into North Carolina when they go to see Santa Crow. So if we could do it in North Carolina, we did, but we really went for the things that, you know, you can't get, and they're just so unique to New Orleans. And the cool thing about that is that it's New Orleans for New Orleans, so it's a great way to show the city. You know, and for me, it was a very sparse and kind of haunted vibe instead of really overly populating it, which can happen. I feel like Banshee's always away from the main, you know, the mainstream. So I was trying to take it all into places, and you know, I was making production crazy because I'm like, we have to shoot a cemetery, we got to get over to the Mardi Gras graveyard,
yeah,
get all these places. But it was really important that we hit, you know, voodoo, the cemeteries, Mardi Gras, the Mississippi, all of that was represented. It was awesome. It was
no
awesome.
Question. Greg, would you actually, and I'm sure now maybe not, but I think it was about the set decoration to this, but would you actually stay, and I want my co-hosts to even answer this for them, would you actually stay in a hotel room with like a decrepit like baby doll's head, you know, just staring at you? I mean, that was pretty a voodoo-centric hotel room where Hood was staying at. Would you yourself stay in a hotel room with like some, you know, Museum of Jurassic Technology artifacts hanging everywhere?
Yeah, well, actually, took that exact kind of setup from, we were scouting these like rooms to rent, rather than like kind of a typical hotel. There's a whole culture of you know, like subletting of rooms, or you know, turning these like stable houses into apartments and so forth in the Quarter. And so, you know, the Quarter is actually a very small place and has its own kind of quality, but the idea, there's the myth of it. And that exact setup that I put in his room was actually in one of the rooms we scouted for that. I was like, oh man, we got to make sure that we, you know, people have all this voodoo tchotchke and voodoo imagery all in their houses. The more we scouted, the more that it's right there in front of you. So seemed appropriate, and also a little nod to Angel Heart.
Yeah. Before we continue, I just really quickly need to mention iTunes and YouTube. Folks, if you want to support AfterBuzz TV, the best way to do it is to rate and review the shows that you listen to or that you watch on YouTube. It is quick, it's easy, it doesn't cost a dime, and you get a great shout-out here on the show.
Two quick shout-outs. JPZL922 says, great podcast. Always providing entertaining commentary and recaps. Enjoy watching guest stars of the shows. Also catching up from Glenn570. He says, great show. I'm in season two of the podcast. It makes me feel like the episode is brand new. I love listening to the old episodes as I'm watching. So I guess we're talking to you from the future, Glenn.
That's great.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you, guys. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
We got a ton of fan questions for Greg.
Oh, great. Let's let her rip.
So thanks to all the fans on Twitter that send in the questions. Tons of questions, Greg, for season four. Specifically, are you going to be showrunning next season?
I am. My day-to-day showrunning responsibilities are going to be divided up between Adam Targum, who's in that, and is going to come on full-time, which is awesome, and Bob Phillips, who's been my producer for the last 2 years. Jonathan's overseeing it globally. I'm still involved with the script development and post-production, but I'm coming on full-time to launch Quarry, which is based on the Max Allen Collins novels by the same name, for Cinemax, and I'm also directing the entire season, so that's running almost simultaneous to season four of Banshee, which is moving up to Pittsburgh. So it's a phenomenal team. The show's in good hands. Jonathan and I are still watching The Fort, so it'll be just the day-to-day choices are going to fall on the team, but it's also the team that's been to the show practically since the beginning, or especially during the seasons. OC's going to be directing half of the season. It's an eight-episode season. It's going to be fantastic, and no one will see the first 10 minutes of season four coming.
Cool.
Speaking of Pittsburgh, a lot of the fans wanted to know why Pittsburgh, and or was season four written with that location in mind, or is it merely just cost?
No, it lends its, I mean, you know, it'll become more clear at the end of season three, but, you know, the show is set in Pennsylvania. We've been faking Pennsylvania in North Carolina. It was unfortunate North Carolina lost its tax incentive, which forced us to move, so bringing the show to Pennsylvania, which is actually one of the states we looked at in season one, is great. And they were able to, you know, sort it all out and to make something attractive to get the show there. So I'm thrilled by the new home.
Didn't you also mention to me that in order to shoot in Pennsylvania, it was something like ever since Witness, nothing has been able to shoot in the state that maligns the Amish community, and that you had to get them to approve
the
show?
We don't malign the Amish community. He loves his niece.
I know. It's a very special relationship.
Such a special
relationship. No, but there was a hang up briefly that, you know, that the state had to engage the Amish community, and I'm sure there was some conversation, but that's kind of inside baseball and not privy to all the nuance of it, but ultimately it worked out that the Amish, you know, gave, you know, but there was something worked out to be able to make that happen.
Super.
Can you share with us why there are only 8 episodes for season 4 and not 10?
I think 8's the new 10. You know, I think with the success of True Detective, it really showed that an 8-episode season can engage and pull people on. I think with Cinemax doing more shows, it's not a signal or a sign of anything. It just seems to be. I mean, I'm doing 8 episodes. Corey's 8 episodes, and that's the first season. So it seems to be the it's becoming more the norm of a first season order, or becoming the norm of orders at Cinemax, it seems.
Yeah.
8 is the new 10.
Do you like it that way? Do you get, I mean, from a storyteller perspective, you know, because you don't have to drag out a lot, you can actually put a lot more in, consolidate a lot more. Does that actually help you? Is that a help, or is it a hindrance, or?
You know, it depends. The things sort of naturally fall into a certain number of episodes. Like if you have 13, you know how to work for that. You know how to work for 10. I think 8, going into it knowing that it was 8, allowed us to tell. I mean, we could have told season 3 in 8 and accelerated other storylines that are coming, but you know, we wanted it mapped out perfectly to 10, and we felt this season. But there was conversation last year if it was going to be an 8-episode season or 10-episode season 3, and you know, we dove in with a 10-episode plan, and I'm actually down with that. So it's been, you know, this has been up for conversation for a little while and isn't a reflection of anything other than what it is, which is just, you know, a tighter episode order. So it's, again, an opportunity to, you know, continue to do what we do well, which is accelerate the story.
And in many ways, this episode feels like it could be a season finale.
Right.
You know, the one thread maybe dangling being the Kai and Emily story. But even that is, a massive cliffhanger that they've been kidnapped, taken to God knows where. But, Stowe as this, like, hulking adversary, the fact that he has this hacker who's looking into Job, that's enough meat to build, potentially a season on instead of two episodes.
There's no, like when you see how packed and how dense the next 2 hours are, I mean, we did structure the season to have multiple season finale type episodes as a way to, keep people on their toes. I think there's a tendency in TV to think like, oh, I'll watch the first couple and then I'll just tune back in at the end. And I wanted to, really have a season. And Jonathan and I really sat and were like, all right, for all the people that are tuning in, we want to reward the people that stay with the show and really make sure that they know every week they don't know what they're going to get, especially, with the last 2 hours. We wanted to feel like, okay, now the season's over. What the hell is this going to be about? And you could have easily slammed the Banshee at the end of episode 8. I was actually worried that people were going to think it was the end of the season or that those were two cliffhanging storylines that we were going to deal with in season 4. So it's almost like you get season 3.5, with the next 2 hours of Banshee in terms of what it does. And where we end up after episode 10, I think will again keep people pretty surprised.
So Greg, I have a question. I don't know if you've noticed, but the Fanshees are asking for me to be on season 4. Who do I have to kill to make this happen?
We should give John the Tropper a call right after we finish.
Okay, right now.
Perfect.
Let's do it. I want to be there.
Excellent.
And I mentioned this before you came on, but blowing half of Chayton's face off there, is that a bit of a nod to Gus Fring and Breaking Bad?
We were aware of it, and it was a point of reference in terms of Zoic's approach. I think that what Breaking Bad did is was innovative and served itself so well. This was really no fitting. More appropriately fitting death for Shane than a big shotgun to the face. in terms of like blowing off half of it and doing something really startling, I think that keeps the tradition of what we've been doing for the last 3 years.
The eye hanging by the optic nerve was my absolute favorite thing, Greg.
Very
sad. We had so many emails about the eyeball.
I bet.
We had all kinds of like, how dangly is too dangly, how much pendulum is too much pendulum. But it's been like, there was a lot of, there was a lot of revisions to that till we got the eyeball just right. Like too much is comical, too little isn't anything. So it was a very tricky balance. But Lonnie and the team at Zoic did a phenomenal job with the effect. And it just, I don't think anybody expects to see something that crazy right in their face.
Absolutely. I know that it happened last episode and we kind of covered it pretty exhaustively in the last podcast. But I just wanted to briefly touch on the heist sequence from episode 7, which, you watch our podcast, you know that we loved it. Is there anything that we didn't mention that you maybe want to share with the Fanshees while you're here about the production of that sequence?
Well, I'm embarrassed to say I'm behind on my AfterBuzz capture.
Oh, put him on the spot.
Sorry.
I'm so into, I've got 80, I've got the... each script I'm getting ready to go into production on. So I've been
works 100 hours a week.
Okay, I get it.
So I don't know what you covered, but I just know from a personal standpoint that I was phenomenally proud of that. And I think it's a real testament to working within limitations, because it was the limitations that we're constantly faced with the show. As big as we make the show seem, we are still a modestly budgeted show. And, we have to be creative in our thinking, and wanting to do something, visually innovate the show and give the show a new visual vocabulary was definitely behind the intention. And, it was a great brainstorm, with Jonathan that eventually led us to doing this kind of first person, multi-camera, no crew visible. We were all hiding, and it was really phenomenal to watch all the years of experience that were on the set needed to be able to mount something so complicated, and yet we all had to unlearn how we've done things for the last 20 years to make that sequence. There's so much intricate work, everything from how the stunt guys sell punches to the way we use reflections to the use of the camera. It was a really exciting new chapter, I think, in a space that I would love to move toward as a filmmaker.
Great.
Wow.
While you're here, can you tell us anything about your new series, about Quarry?
Absolutely. Quarry is based on the novels of Max Allen Collins. It's created by Michael Fuller, Graham Gordy, with anonymous content. And it's who brought True Detective and the Nick under there. Quarry takes place in 1972 Memphis. It's about a Vietnam vet who returns home, can't really assimilate back in society due to a very controversial event that happened while he was in Vietnam, and is recruited by the Dixie Mafia to become a hitman.
Cool.
And this is the origin story in many ways of the character that people have come to know in the books that Max Collins wrote. Yeah. And Graham Gordy and Michael Fuller have really taken them and inhabited them and infused them with a world and a life that people that love the books will love the show, and people that will watch the show will find the books in their future to be able to continue on. So it's it's definitely part of but it's definitely part of a much more grounded pulp storytelling vibe for me.
Are you going to include the Memphis sound in your new series? Speaking of music, you're going to
have
a lot.
Very much. We have Dave Porter, who's really the cornerstone of Stax, is consulting with us, working with Neophonic again in terms of curating that sound and creating a sound that I hope people will that either who are familiar or who aren't familiar, but really can introduce a new world to the music, and that's something that is so culturally important. We are going to go shoot part of it in Memphis. It is something that is a real passion project for Carrie Antolis, president of Cinemax. Mm-hmm. It's but the sound and the music is going to be huge for us.
Yeah, well, I'm a huge fan of Max Allen Collins. He wrote Road to Perdition. That's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Amazing.
So we're all very, very excited about that. Any other questions for Greg about season three? I mean, do you have a favorite episode of this season?
Do I?
Yeah. I know we do, but
they all sneak up on me. Episode three was so pulpy and entertaining for me. When I watched it, I relished in how how crazy the storytelling is in that, and that that signals the boundary pushing of the show. Five was a phenomenal piece of filmmaking, of course, as it was the year before with what Bobbick did on Shoot About Unicorns. So,
quick question, sorry to interrupt, but did ask if Bobbick is going to be back.
Bobbick's doing a movie. He wasn't available to us, and I don't think he's going to be available to us next year, but he's obviously a talent. What's great is pretty much everybody that's come on the floor for us. Magnus Martin's got a movie going, OC's got movies going, so you come into Banshee and big things lay ahead, which is really the parent of the show. It's very rewarding to see everybody go off and be doing their next big thing. So Banshee's a great place to bring in Scott Nemus over at Cinemax with a great ear to the ground for talent that's brewing overseas, and we're able to Cinemax is a place that takes chances and brings people over that haven't directed American television, and now we see really talent blossoming out there and being exposed, and careers taking off. It's really thrilling.
Wonderful.
Well, really quick, Greg, just want to say that when you do film in Pittsburgh, have a Permani sandwich. I'm telling you, I don't know if you ever had
Permani
one.
Sandwich?
Permani sandwich. Yeah, it's
oh my God, it's
the most awesome, just greasy spoon sandwich you've ever had in your life if you haven't had one.
All right, I'm down for that.
Absolutely.
Rad. Can you tell us anything about these next two episodes to come?
I think Lonnie did a beautiful job directing, especially for episode 10. It'll deliver a very, very satisfying finales to come. You're going to see Colonel Stowe exact his revenge. We have a great new storyline that has been brewing in the background for Proctor, which will leave Proctor never the same. There's a lot to come. There's still a lot left on the table. So I'm excited for people. And the thing I can tell you is that the Banshee Saga is going to be premiering, and we're very excited about that as well, closer to the finale. So that's going to take, really, for the first time, all our new media content, our old media content, merge them together and really create an 11th episode of the season that everybody can enjoy on various platforms.
Very cool.
More about that coming in the weeks to come.
Nice. That's great. Well, Greg, I want to thank you so much for joining us. It's always a pleasure talking to you. And the third season has just been flat out phenomenal start to finish. So awesome. You should be incredibly proud.
It's been a really gratifying to see all the hard work that's gone into the show, you know, when we were sweating it out in the hardest days of summer, and seeing how far this team has pushed and seeing people respond. And, you know, it's a great narrative for us to keep pushing, to keep raising that bar without ever getting too over the top. So thank you so much. And you guys have been so phenomenally supportive. It's fantastic. And what's great is I have a great AfterBuzz binge session ahead. When things settle down a little bit over here.
Cool. Super. Can't wait to see Quarry, and all the best on the shoot.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
All right.
Take care.
Bye.
All right, bye. He's just the best.
Isn't he the best?
Yeah. Awesome. All right. Let's talk about some predictions, shall we?
Right.
Yeah.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
All right, folks. Two episodes yet remain. Chayden has been dealt with, but Kai has been kidnapped. Stowe, I think, is on to Carrie.
He definitely is.
He's definitely okay. He's on to Carrie. There's no one else who could have gotten close enough to get his handprint and his voice print.
Yeah, he's even touching the table like this is where it happened. He's brewing something.
And you notice the ring when he did the ring. That's from the opening credits.
Yes.
Yeah.
The bleeding ring.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens next week? Did we see the scenes from next week after the episode?
No.
What I saw, and if you consider this spoilers, now's the time to drop out.
Spoiler alert!
Yeah.
Spoiler alert!
Stowe pays Sugar a visit. We see a scene of Hood without his beard, which I may be wondering if that's a flashback sequence. We see, I think, Carrie captured by Stowe and hanging from the ceiling by her wrists.
Oh my gosh. It could just be some kinky stuff.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Like 50 Shades of Grey stuff going on.
He's super into that.
Okay.
Yes.
He's into violent sex. Anything from the Phoenix Gallery?
Nothing about kinky sex.
I think Burton's going to save the day with at least Kai. I mean, he's going to, Kai saved Burton, so Burton's going to do the same.
One man war machine?
Exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. Or what's going to happen is actually, I think even though Hood is, still wants to attack Kai, I think he's going to have some mercy on him and even maybe also play a role in maybe helping Kai out since Kai is turning this new leaf.
Hmm.
Yeah, excited to see that. Excited to see what happens with Rebecca and Kai because, I mean, all of her sort of dealings are, it has to catch up with her at some point. Also, you know, because when Adam was in here, he said they never sort of leave any thread untied. We've built up a decent amount about Kurt Bunker.
Yeah.
And I feel like, we only have two episodes left, but I feel like we're going to find out backstory with him, maybe some of the old crew.
That was another scene from next week.
I didn't see it.
It was a shot of him apparently kicking someone's face in.
Ooh.
Yeah. I was going to say something with like his old crew or some of the guys he used to roll with, which I'm fascinated to find out.
Yeah, absolutely. Oriana?
I don't have any predictions. I think it's going to be amazing. What I wrote down was I think that the groundbreaking work they did on episode 7 with the GoPros and the fight scene is going to be mimicked but never matched.
Oh yes.
Greg, that's
keep
for
shooting
you.
That was beautiful.
That was beautiful.
Yeah. For me, the thing I'm most curious about is just like Stowe to me is such an incomparable force to be reckoned with. He's very scary. I want to see how they're going to get out of this. The thing that I'm like super curious about is this other hacker who has somehow figured out Job's existence. Mm-hmm. Job has never had anyone ever like pursuing him in this way.
Mm-hmm.
He's always been kind of free from danger in a sense, other than the danger that Hood brings into his life.
Other than the salon, the hair salon.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Like Rabbit's gone. So another hacker who, you know, while maybe not as good as him, Job may not be aware that he's after him and could get the drop on him in some way.
Yeah.
That to me is very, very cool. It's a type of enemy that we've never seen on the show.
Yeah.
So that really interests me. I'm interested in meeting the mysterious Frasier for the first time.
Yeah.
And yeah, I have to imagine that Kai's change to the good to the light side isn't going to last very long.
But we know that he's always prepared, and he might have a razor in his mouth.
Yes.
He may, because that's what he does. Quick bit of trivia: the actor that plays that hacker, friends with Tom Pelfrey from I think high school.
No
he
mentioned really?
That. He mentioned that last week when he was in here.
Great job with Tom, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, thank
great
you very show. Much. Excellent. All right, folks, that's going to be all for us this week. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that you enjoyed Mr. Greg Yaitanes. If you're not following him on Twitter, you totally should.
Yes.
That's at Greg Yaitanes.
At Greg Yaitanes, Y-A-I-T-A-N-E-S.
He live tweets every Friday night for the show, and has incredible trivia that you wouldn't know otherwise.
Lots of great insight. Oriana, where can the people find you?
People can find me on Twitter at Miss Oriana Leo or on Instagram at Oriana Leo. I'm on YouTube.com/TheOrianaLeo and I'm just starting to post behind the scenes videos on Snapchat. It's MISS_Ori on Snapchat. And also thank you to all the Fanshee babes out there. You guys are amazing. All of the questions, I don't have enough time to mention you by name, but thank you.
All right. And Monis.
You can find me on Twitter at Rest Fiction. That stands for Restaurant Fiction. On iTunes at Restaurant Fiction, restaurantfiction.com. Be on the lookout. We are going to be broadcasting our review on Gusteau's, which was prominently featured in the film Ratatouille. We went down to France and we got a huge, we got to see the wine cellar and all that, which is pretty amazing.
So and wait. Isaac.
You can follow me on Twitter at Isaac Johnson. Instagram, the Isaac Johnson. You can also check out my YouTube page, The Isaac Johnson. Check out my music video and a short film that I was in. Thank you.
And I was going to interrupt you, Matt. One thing, I'm starting Dig this week, which is a kind of event on USA, 10 episodes.
Ooh.
It's supposed to be kind of a murder mystery, thriller, archaeology, history.
Jason awesome. Isaacs is in it, correct?
Yes.
Awesome. He's fantastic.
He's amazing.
Yeah. And folks, you can find me on Twitter at Matt Lieberman. That's MattLieberman. You can also find me here on AfterBuzz doing Better Call Saul and Helix. My personal channel on YouTube, youtube.com/C/MattLieberman. SourceFed and SourceFed Nerd. I want to thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff. We would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Fanshees rule!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.